Here we're going to talk about the principle of transmissibility in terms of forces and moments. Now, we've established, hopefully, that I can take a force and I can apply it. Let's see, the force can be applied anywhere on a body as long as it's on the same line of action. So if I've got some kind of thing shaped like this, whatever this happens to be, if I have a force applied here, I could take that same force and actually apply it anywhere along this line, and that's completely acceptable. Keep going. So I could apply it here, I could apply it here, I could apply it here, or at any point along here, as long as I maintain the orientation of the force, and as long as the place where I apply it is along the same line of action as the original force. Got it? So there's that for forces. Now, we can also move the force with a C, perpendicularly, if we balance it off with a couple moment. Okay. So the idea might be, okay, well, I can go ahead and I can take this guy and I can move him perpendicularly, say, this way. But I would note that while I'm doing this, now I'm going to be rotating. I'm going to be wanting to rotate this way. So I have to add a couple moment to make it rotate the opposite direction. And we talked about how we can take these couple moments and move them around. So it doesn't really matter where I actually put it. But the idea would be that I could take, if I'm going to go ahead and move the force that way, I can do that as long as I do the couple moment. Now if I'm going to move the force the other way, now I have a tendency to want to rotate this direction, so I have to put in a balancing couple moment going the opposite direction. So I can move the force perpendicularly as long as I add in a couple moment. Now, theoretically, I'd really need to move it along the line of action over this way, because it still has to be actually touching. But I can do that as long, basically, I can move the force where I need it to be as long as I take it. Account for the fact that I'm going to be messing something up and try to fix it. So it makes a little bit more sense, or maybe it already makes sense, or maybe it will never make sense. Hopefully we don't do that. If I have a force here, okay, some force. Now, if I want to move the force, I can move the force here, and there's no change, right? It's just the same. Okay, now assuming this is in equilibrium, if it's not, I can move the force this way, but if I think about it, if I've moved it over, say, D, what's happened is now I'm trying to make it rotate to the left in a way that it wouldn't necessarily be rotating before. So to accommodate that, I have to create a moment of magnitude F times D to make up for the fact that I am now that I'm now messing with it. And from here, now that I've got that done, if I wanted to, as long as I stayed a distance D away and kept that couple moment, I could actually take the force and I could move it along the line of action anyway this way, because I've maintained the couple moment. So once I move it and put in the couple moment, I can go ahead and continue to move it along the line. So these are all these here are all equivalent. Now, where this becomes more significant, or it's already significant, but where this becomes perhaps more interesting, is in 3D. So say we have some kind of a blob. Blob, 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 blob. And this blob has several forces acting on it. And these are all 3D forces. So we have some kind of R1, F1 thing going on. And we have some kind of R2, F2 thing going on. And we have some kind of R3, F3 going on. Now, what the principle of transmissibility says is I can either take, there's actually several ways I could do this. In fact, let me make it a little bit more interesting. And I'm going to take an arbitrary M going this way and to say, oh, I have another moment going on over here. Now, what I can do is I can come in here and I can calculate the moments created by all these different forces. So, in fact, let me make this a little bit smaller so we'll all fit on a page. Got it? What this says is that I can replace this here, if I want to move all my forces to the same location, for some reason, if I need to do that to make the problem easier to solve, let me actually make a copy and go at it this way. I swear I'll figure out what I'm doing eventually. The idea is that I could take this guy, I could take this force here, and I could move him, thank you, perpendicularly back to here, right? I could take this force, and I could move him perpendicularly back to here, as long as I take into account that I now have a new moment pointing some direction that is equal to R1 cross F1. And it doesn't matter specifically where I draw because it's a couple moment. Okay. Let's see. I'm going to go ahead and draw it coming out of there. I think that actually makes more sense. Oh, yeah, duh. Of course it matters where I draw it out. Don't listen to me. I don't know what I'm talking about. Like that. This is my couple moment. That's what I meant to say. Okay. So I'm going to replace that there. Now I can take this guy, and if I want to, I can bring him back this direction as long as I replace him, or replace this R with some other moment, M2, I'm getting there, I swear, cross F2. Now I can take F3, and I can move him this direction, and then I can move him along his line of action. So I can move him perpendicularly, and then I can move him along the line of action. And I can get rid of the associated position vector as long as I promise, on my honor, to replace him with, and I think he's kind of got messed up, as long as I promise to replace him with M3, which is R3 cross F3. Okay? So now what I can actually do is, now that I've replaced all these guys with their couple moments, they are a couple moments, I'm just getting there slowly. Now that I have all these different forces, they're all coming out of the same spot. So now I can combine the forces to be some new force, FR, being equal to F1 plus F2 plus F3. I can add all the moments together, including this one, wherever he is. Some resultant moment equal to M plus M1 plus M2 plus M3. And this guy here is actually going to be another free vector. So I can move him around if I need to along his line of action. Okay? So it's kind of cool. I'm going to try to separate these guys out. They kind of run them together. that I can take something that looks as weird as this and, you know, as strange as this, and I can take all those forces and put them from the same spot as long as I'm willing to replace those positions with moments, and then I can take everything in over here now that I've colored all over my entire page. Maybe it'll make more sense. But it's kind of neat because this is how you can write equivalent systems. And so you're just going to have a ton of problems where you are or you're replacing things with equivalent systems. Kind of a classic problem to look at is, say you've got you know, like a traffic light going on. So traffic light. Let's say this one is some distance one away, and this one is distance two away. Say this has a weight one, and this has a weight two. Now, I can leave it like that, or what I can do is I can say, well, if I want to move the forces over here, I can do that, and I can say that they have a force of weight one plus weight two, and I can do that as long as I add an equivalent couple to resist that motion of, in this case, since it's a 2D system, I could do it in scalar, W1D1 plus W2D2. And I can say that that's an equivalent system because it has the same net translation and rotation on it. I could also, if I got really desperate, could happen. You never know. You're like, oh my gosh, if I don't move this force, I'm going to go crazy. Since these are free vectors, I could always go in here and I could move this force down to the base because I'm staying along the line of action. And the line of action of this couple moment is at the K position, at the K. So I could move it down here if I needed to. I could call it W1, D1, W2, D2. And again, these here are all equivalent systems. And the ability to determine equivalent systems is actually very, very important in figuring out how to solve statics problems, ultimately. And the idea is that all of these problems have the same need for translation and rotation. The moment is causing a tendency to want to rotate. The force is causing a tendency to want to translate. And in any of these three pictures, the net need to translate or rotate is going to come out to be the exact same thing. Now, if I can make this a little bit more interesting, let me take the same picture that we had here and I'll use it again. I can take this guy here. Like we said, I can replace it by creating a moment at this point. But what I could also do is, again, given these guys here and here, I could choose an arbitrary point here to apply both of these weights, and then choose an arbitrary distance at which to place it, such that the moments will be the same. So in this case, that I could say that the net moment would be weight 1D1 plus weight 2D2. So I can replace it with this system over here as long as the net moment still is equivalent to the previous one. Now here, it's going to be the distance times the new weight. So to figure out what that distance D is, I need to set these two equal to each other to determine at what distance I should place the equivalent weight. And so in this case, it would be W1D1 plus W2D2 all over weight 1 plus weight 2. So that's how I could figure out what that distance would be. That would be the equivalent distance here, where I would get, again, another equivalent system. And so there's all these problems where you're trying to simplify these kinds of issues and figure out, well, what's this and what's this? But what it all really comes down to is, at the end of the day, I want to have the exact same weight, not the weight, the exact same moment and the exact same net force of zero in statics that I had before. So I can move the force as long as I take for account the fact that if I move the force, I might be inducing a moment. I need to uninduce it. You'll get these problems in something called reduction to a wrench, where, you know, here we were lucky because everything was kind of perpendicular to each other. If I wanted to move something into a different location that wasn't quite the same, I just have to come up with, you know, comparing the X, Y, and Z components. So I think whenever you try to solve these problems, especially if you're doing them in 3D, if you just solve it component by component, it can make things much, much easier. And the whole point, again, is just to remember that you're trying to take what you currently have and turn it into a system where everything's equivalent. Whatever force you had, you still have that force. Whatever tendency to rotate you have, you still have that tendency to rotate. So at the end of the day, you have an equivalent system. Just hopefully the forces are in such a way that it's easier for you to solve it with whatever it is you're trying to do to it.